Good morning, everyone. My name is Keisha Wright. Nicole Bruner and I are the program coordinators for the House of Representatives, and we would like to welcome you to the conclusion of the Spring 2023 House Fellowship Program. This year marks the 41st anniversary of the House Fellowship Program, begun in 1982 and administered by the Bipartisan Management Committee and the Office of the Chief Clerk. The fellowship program's purpose is to provide students with a short, in-depth, and hands-on look at the workings of state government. During a 13-week semester, the selected students work with experienced staff of government and policy. They have worked diligently on drafting bills and resolutions, letters and memos, and have conducted countless hours of policy research. They have attended weekly workshops, presentations, and tours, and have had the opportunity to attend committee meetings and hearings, as well as house session. They have learned the entire legislative process from beginning, coming up with an idea, to the end, a bill becoming a law. Over the last 41 years, over 400 students have completed the House Fellowship Program. Many of these students continue their education in schools throughout the country. About half of the students who completed the program since 2007 have found employment in and around state government, something in which we are very proud. These five students have had an incredible 13-week adventure. In just that short time, they have shown growth, growth in knowledge, experience, maturity, and confidence. Their writing skills have improved. Their ability to communicate with workshop presenters, staff, and members have become clearer and more direct. They have worked hard throughout the semester to get to this point. Their major assignment was to develop a piece of legislation, from coming up with an idea through introducing it as a bill. There are many steps in between in which they were responsible. Research the idea, draft an outline, revise that outline, meet with legislative attorneys to create the bill, more research, talk with stakeholders, more revisions, finalize the bill, create an analysis, and today present the bill to all of you. One by one, the students will present their legislation. There are program books on the tables that you can review during the presentation. They contain copies of the bill, bill analysis or summary, and other supporting documents. When each student is finished with their remarks, the floor will be open for questions. The students are prepared to defend their bill. If you do have a question, please walk up to the two microphones placed in the room. The presentation is being recorded, so I ask that you speak into the microphones clearly and concisely, and please respect the various viewpoints supported throughout the room. I'd like to take a moment to offer a few thanks. First, to the family, friends, professors, and advisors that have encouraged these students over the years. Thank you for directing and supporting them and allowing them to participate in this program. To the speakers who participated in the weekly workshops, tours, presentations, and meetings, thank you for sharing your experiences and passing your knowledge on to the students. These participants are listed in your programs. I want to thank all the chairmen and women and the supervisors from the committees and leadership offices, and to the Chief Clerk, Brooke Wheeler, and Deputy Chief Clerks, Angela Candori and Ray Whitaker, for continuing to support and promote not just the Legislative Fellowship Program, but all the internship opportunities in the House of Representatives. And a special thank you to Peter Klein and the drafting attorneys and the Legislative Reference Bureau. Your support helps make this program possible, and the extra time you take to move these ideas forward is beyond appreciated. Thank you to the former fellows, some of which are here today, for continual support and promotion of the program. And now I'll turn it over to Nicole.
Good morning. At this time, I would like to introduce the legislative fellows in order of their presentations. And I will also introduce their supervisors. So if you could please stand when recognized. First, we have Katarina Kaufman, a student from Pennsylvania State University College of Agricultural Sciences, and she was assigned to Representative Dan Mao in the Agricultural and Rural Affairs Committee. Her supervisor was Carrie Golden. Next is Dalton Dombrowski, and Dalton was assigned to the Gaming and Oversight Committee with Hank Beaver as his supervisor, and Bob Brownwell is here, and also Christina Conselman under Rep. Harkins. Okay. Next is Ariana Jenna, who attends Lebanon Valley College. She was assigned to Representative Robert Freeman in the local government committee. Her supervisor was John Castelli, and I believe they are actually at the budget hearings right now, so they might be joining us later. We also have Nathaniel McLeod, a Dickinson College student, and he was assigned to the Democratic Legislative Policy and Research Office. His supervisor was Jerry Morris. And last, we have Alex Simmons. He attends Penn State Harrisburg, and he was assigned to serve Representative Carrie Benninghoff in the Transportation Committee. His supervisor was Josiah Shelley. As I mentioned, our first presenter will be Katarina, and her legislation is providing for the establishment of the Pennsylvania Preferred Market Match Program and funding for the program.
Good morning. My name is Katarina Kaufman, and I'm a junior at Penn State University studying animal science with a focus on agribusiness management. I'm from rural Huntington County, where I grew up on my grandparents' dairy farm, Tom Glow Farms, where my family takes pride in producing safe, affordable, and nutrient-dense food. As a dairy farmer and an animal science major, it's my duty to look for on-farm and policy solutions to improve food access, as well as preserve Pennsylvania's rich agricultural heritage. Nearly 1.5 million Pennsylvanians are food insecure. That's over 9.2% of the population. Food insecurity affects rural communities, suburban communities, and urban communities. But I didn't see food insecurity in rural Huntington County until the pandemic, when my sister and I delivered over 50 lunches to students in West, Barry, and Logan townships. This effort, in collaboration with area churches, distributed over 150 lunches to students in the Juniata Valley School District. This, in addition to area milk drops, where I helped deliver over 7,212 gallons of milk, 1,800 pounds of butter, and 750 pounds of cheese, helped local families in the northern and southern end of my county. However, nearly 2 years after the pandemic, there's still food insecurity in rural communities like mine. Just last month, my family helped pass out over 11,000 pounds of food to over 120 families in northern Huntington County. Food insecurity is real, and it's everywhere. Food assistance programs such as SNAP and WIC play a critical role in helping families acquire food. However, these programs sometimes make it difficult for families still to receive access to fresh food products such as fruits, vegetables, and dairy milk. In fact, these three items are the most requested items at food banks. The federal government in the 2008 Farm Bill sponsored a pilot program to identify if SNAP beneficiaries who receive a 30-cent incentive to purchase fresh fruits and vegetables, if they would further consume more of these vegetables because it's more accessible. The study that took place from 2011 to 2012 concluded that SNAP beneficiaries who received the incentive were 11% more likely to consume and purchase fresh fruits and vegetables than those who did not receive that incentive. Furthermore, from this study, the federal government has sponsored a series of grant programs to establish further fresh food access programs for SNAP beneficiaries across the country. I'm grateful that in Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, a group called the Food Trust Nutrition Incentive have utilized that program and have provided SNAP beneficiaries with a $2 Food Bucks coupon for every $5 spent at local farmers markets. This program has been integral because it has stretched the food purchasing power of these families by nearly 30%. And while these programs have been successful, the fact is, it's not accessible to communities like mine in Huntington. And that is kind of the basis of why my bill is here today. My bill would establish the Pennsylvania Preferred Market Match, a statewide program where SNAP and WIC beneficiaries from across the Commonwealth would have the same access to these incentives like there are many already are in cities. My bill would provide SNAP and WIC beneficiaries a 2-for-1 market match on all Pennsylvania preferred fruits and vegetables and a $1 discount on all dairy milk sold at retail food establishments. And a retail food establishment could range from a farmer's market, a grocery store, or even a farm market. This improves greater accessibility. My program would be administered by the Department of Human Services, or the Department of Human Services could choose to contract the program to a food access organization already established within the Commonwealth. This is a win-win for both SNAP and low-income families, as well as Pennsylvania farmers like myself. Why, you may ask? Well, not only are we improving beneficiaries' access to fresh and nutrient-dense foods, but we're also removing barriers that prevent many beneficiaries from already receiving these benefits. My program would take place in store, which would remove transportation barriers that prevent some beneficiaries from participating in already federal-sponsored programs. Furthermore, it's an investment in Pennsylvania farmers, agribusinesses, and the economy. We're encouraging the consumption of Pennsylvania-produced foods, and we're also encouraging retail food establishments to look at sourcing their fresh fruits and vegetables and dairy locally and within the state. That supports Pennsylvania jobs and Pennsylvania businesses, a win-win for me. Furthermore, it's encouraging Pennsylvania farmers and agribusinesses to join the Pennsylvania Preferred Program and further trademark their goods to make it more marketable and visible within the marketplace. Now, I would not have been able to write this bill or go through any of this process without a few very special people. And first, I would like to thank my executive director, Carrie Golden, for her friendship and her mentorship over the past 13 weeks. She has been a critical role in helping this ag kid embrace more of the agricultural policy that I might not have exposure to within my current curriculum. I would also like to thank her Democratic counterpart, Destiny, for her support in my journey as well. I would also like to thank Chairman Mao for his kindness, as well as his push to get me to look at different items, as well as just talk about commercial agriculture across the Commonwealth. I know firsthand that with Destiny, Carrie, as well as Dan and Eddie, Pennsylvania agriculture is in great hands. I would also like to thank Keisha and Nicole for all of their hard work in coordinating this program and giving us the speakers and the workshops for us to gain all these experience for me today. I would also like to thank my fellowship classmates for their help and encouragement along the way. At this time, I'm willing to yield the rest of my time for any questions regarding my legislative bill or my time here. Thank you.
Okay, so great speech. So I wanted to ask about your PA Preferred Market Match Program. Mm-hmm. So you talk about it benefiting participating retail food establishments.
Yes.
Would mom and pop, like corner stores, also benefit from this program?
Yeah, great question. So any store could really participate in this program as long as they're selling the Pennsylvania Preferred items that we're looking for. So that is the Pennsylvania Preferred fruits, vegetables, and dairy products. So if they are selling those products, they're able to register, and they'll do so by contacting the Department of Human Services or the contracted party.
Okay, great. Yeah. And then I forget what it stands for, but FAO, the
Food Access Organization.
Okay.
Yes.
What are examples of those organizations?
Yes, so that could be your Central Pennsylvania Food Bank. That could be Feeding Pennsylvania. It could be any organization that works as a nonprofit to establish access to food within the Commonwealth.
All right, thank you very much.
Yep.
Thanks, Katarina. Our next presenter is Dalton Dombrowski, and his legislation is establishing the student teacher stipend program and the student teacher stipend fund, imposing duties on the Pennsylvania Higher Education Assistance Agency, providing for an interfund transfer and making appropriations. Dalton.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Dalton Dombrowski, and I'm a student from Elizabethtown College, and I had the opportunity this spring to work in the Democratic Gaming Oversight Committee. I want to thank Hank Beaver and Bob Branowell for welcoming me as part of the team and always making me feel welcome during my time here and for being available for any questions that I had. Thank you to Keisha Wright and to Nicole Bruner for putting this together and welcoming us aboard the program. I would also like to thank Stephen Rare, who challenged me and guided me during my 13 weeks here and helped me create a polished final piece of legislation. My legislation, the Fund Our Future Educators Act, hopes to address the current teacher shortage that we are experiencing in all 50 states. In Pennsylvania, we are having a very difficult time with retaining and recruiting new educators into the field. 2010, there were more than 21,000 college students who earned their teacher certification. 2023, there were less than 7,000. While the entire nation is experiencing this shortage, Pennsylvania, unfortunately, is suffering even more than the average state. As a whole, the United States has seen a one-third drop-off the number of new teachers entering the field, whereas Pennsylvania has seen a two-thirds drop-off during this time period. Our pipeline of teachers is drying up, and we need to act soon. To maintain our high quality of education here in the Commonwealth, we must put forth the investment to support our current teachers and encourage new teachers to enter the field. According to Teach Plus, the National Center on Education and Economy, our shortage is at a record high. If we cannot reverse this and bring in new educators who will stay in the field, then this will create a cycle that will have devastating effects both on teachers and students. We need teachers to help produce a leading generation in the future. If we continue to have this shortage, then classroom sizes will grow, our students will lack the individualized support that they need, and more teachers will leave from being overworked and underpaid. Our students will be the first to suffer. Our students won't have the ability to build long-lasting positive relationships with their teachers, and they will be in much harder to manage classrooms, and this will harm the stability of their learning. My bill will help thousands of college students who are preparing to become educators. Right now, all of these candidates are dealing with the same problems that millions of Pennsylvanians face. They have living expenses that are made worse by inflation, they have to pay their rent, and they have to put food on the table. Student teaching is a full-time job. These students work 40 hours a week in the classroom, and they spend hours more on weekends preparing for the following week. And they make nothing for their time. And not only do they make nothing, but for their time spent teaching for over 40 hours a week, they must pay their colleges and universities thousands of dollars of tuition for that time spent to student teaching. These students pay thousands of dollars while making nothing to become certified teachers. That is not a fair system. While the majority of internships available to the students today are paid opportunities, if you want to become a teacher, your circumstance is different. To become a certified teacher, you must commit to 3 or 4 months of full-time work for which you are not paid for. With this in mind, my bill provides for financial assistance for students who are entering one of the state's fields with the highest demand. Each student who meets the criteria of this stipend will receive an amount of $5,000 during their 12-week program. This stipend will help students during this period with food, rental payments, gas transporting them to and from their placements, and other resources that they might need. The $5,000 will be dispersed to the individual upon the start of their student teacher placement as one lump sum. While $5,000 may seem like a large amount to be given at one time to the student, it averages to about $10.40 an hour over the length of their placement. By giving the money to the student as a lump sum, we are able to get money into the hands of individuals faster and allow them to better plan out their living expenses. My legislation asks FIA to accept and respond to applications and to disperse the funds during the administration of this program. While I would like to help all student teachers who are going through the placements, my bill considers the financial cost of such a program. Therefore, I propose financial assistance to the groups who would need that assistance the most. The stipend will be applicable to student teachers whose expected family contribution would be within 200% the maximum Pell Grant eligibility. This means that those who need assistance will get it. Right now, these students already have to make sacrifices as they are making their way through college and doing full-time and unpaid student teaching places an unfair burden upon them. While many students already work during the school year, some work in multiple jobs, this is not quite possible when enrolled in a student teaching program, working the classroom Monday through Friday and preparing for your placement over the weekend. This $5,000 stipend that this bill provides would help to remedy this. My bill would remove potential barriers for keeping future educators from joining the profession. Students who receive the stipend will not have as much stress wondering about how they're going to provide for themselves or how they're going to financially survive through their placement. And in a time where teachers are hard to come by, it's time we put our energy and our funds into trying to help those who are coming into the profession and want to make a difference in the lives of our children. As a legislator, we need to create a solution for this inequity. The cost of my legislation will not just fall in the hands of Pennsylvania's taxpayers. To help with the mission of reducing the teacher shortage in Pennsylvania, my legislation requires a contribution from the institutions of higher education here in the Commonwealth. If all institutions can devote $25,000 to the Department of Education for the purpose of providing these stipends, then this will provide a revenue of more than $7 million. My legislation asks for $7 million per year from Pennsylvania's general fund to fund this program. With the modest of our colleges, trade schools, and universities, we can minimize the effect that this program has on our taxpayers. You might ask, why should the colleges have to chip into this program? Each student that goes through Pennsylvania's colleges and universities is benefited from the work that teachers do. The engineers, doctors, lawyers, business owners, they have all been impacted by a teacher during their journey. They come to these colleges to further their education, and they bring with them the set of skills that they have learned during their time in our public and private school systems. They bring a tuition to these colleges, and together, I feel that we have a collective responsibility to tackle the issue of the teacher shortage. In the end, all of Pennsylvania can benefit from this legislation accomplishes. While my legislation does not completely solve the issue that we face with teacher shortages, it will take one step forward to addressing one of the many problems that teachers face. It will help to address inequity that student teachers face when compared to many other professions who do pay their interns for optional opportunities. If this bill is passed, we can provide meaningful assistance to future educators during the time preparing to be in the classroom as a fully certified teacher. We can help those who are spending years and thousands of hours preparing to serve in the high-demand field that is constitutionally required to be given to all of Pennsylvania's children. In the future, I would support legislation that would waive tuition fees for all of Pennsylvania's student teachers. But student teaching is a problem with many issues. Student teaching is full-time work, and it's time that we pay our student teachers for the work they provide in our classrooms. It's time that we end our tradition of unpaid labor in this Commonwealth. As President Barack Obama has said, the men and women who teach our children fulfill the promise of a nation that's always looking forward, that believes that each generation has a responsibility in building this great country of ours and making the world a better place. Let us help these men and women who will bring Pennsylvania forward, our nation forward, and our children forward. Thank you for your time today. I will now yield for any questions. Morning.
I have a couple questions for you. Okay, so on the first page of your bill, you talk about the number of new educators going from 20,000 in 2010 to 6,000 in 2022. Can you provide some examples for why this happened?
Well, I believe that the teachers have a great variety of new responsibilities put upon them. During the pandemic, we saw how teachers were in the middle of the crisis that we faced with COVID-19. They had to be mass monitors. They had to enforce the policies that were put upon them, and all while being heavily underpaid. Teaching has not seen their wages go up in a long time. And while other fields have seen their wages gone up, teaching, unfortunately, because of inflation, other issues, it means they have lost money during this time. And I think that's why a lot of teachers have left the field.
Okay. So the pandemic was in 2020. there was 20,000 in 2010. So you would say that the largest factor in this was being them being underpaid.
I think underpaid and the responsibilities that are put upon them, yes.
Okay, thank you. And then my second question, I saw this as a program, but it seems to only go for 5 years. Was that done intentionally, or what was your reason for only doing 5 years instead of just a long-term program?
I would like to do 5 years to give the legislator a chance to assess its effectiveness after 5 years. Perhaps we can raise the funds, or we can see what the shortage looks like in 5 years, but I think that would be a reasonable amount of time to judge the effects of this program.
So if the program was going well, then you would consider re-upping it after the first 5 years?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Morning.
First and foremost, congratulations on the bill. I think it's
Thank you. Very well written.
Just two questions. You noted that the application requires the name, address, telephone number of the eligible student. On campus, across universities, there's an issue of homelessness with students, and I just wanted to know how, what you may change to incorporate to allow homeless students who are student teachers be able to qualify for this, because they may be eligible, but because the application requires an address, that may prove difficult for them who need that resource.
Well, that's a great question. Something that I would consider in amendments, I would consider maybe allowing them to put their school mailbox. I know if you're a student at a college, you have access to that, so that could be an option for these students.
Understood. And then the second question for clarification. So a school, a university is required to pay in $25,000 for this program.
Mm-hmm.
I know for a private institution that has a large endowment, that may be a smaller contribution compared to other projects that they invest in. But for state schools that you know get their funding from appropriations, it's very tight and limited. So, mm-hmm. what are some consequences of taking $25,000 from a university's line item in their funding? Because that money was going to go somewhere. If now they're required to pay $25,000 somewhere else, what are some unintended consequences of this?
Well, it's certainly something that we can consider. It could go towards other program. It could go towards scholarships. There may be a financial sacrifice that has to be made. But during amendment process, we could consider having these smaller schools pay a lesser amount and having a scale to ensure that the bigger colleges pay a larger portion towards this fund. Okay. So I would welcome a change.
Understood. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
A lifetime ago, I was a student teacher, as was my wife, but she was student teacher of the year. I barely made it, so this will be a softball question for you. But I'm wondering, have you discovered any data in other states where this kind of incentive has been tried, or even other disciplines where, you know, like legislative fellows get paid, or others where you've seen that move the needle for recruitment?
Well, this has been a more recent trend. Recently, we've seen Michigan, Oklahoma, and Colorado introduce some programs. So it's hard to say right now what the impact is. It's all happened, I'd say, like during the pandemic and the years falling. So we're going to need to watch the data and see if teaching enrollment goes up or how it affects the students through their reports. But I expect it to have a positive effect. Thank you.
Thanks, Dalton. Next is Ariana. Her legislation is amending the Act of November 24, 1976, entitled An Act Providing for the Rights and Duties of Manufactured Homeowners or Operators and Manufactured Home Lessees, further providing for sale or lease of manufactured home communities, and providing for exemption from real estate realty transfer tax. Ariana.
Good morning. My name is Ariana, and this past semester I was placed in the local government committee under Representative Freeman, and my supervisor was John Castelli. I'm a political science and social justice double major at Lebanon Valley College, and I'm graduating this spring. And before I start my presentation, I'd like to give a huge thank you to Nicole and Keisha for giving us all this opportunity, putting this program together, putting today together. Thank you. I'd also like to thank my former fellows for just being such amazing peers. And I'd also really like to thank my committee staff, John, Bree, Christina, and of course, Chairman Freeman. You all have been so welcoming, so kind, and have taught me so much. And it makes me very sad that tomorrow I won't see you, but I'm so glad I've gotten to know you. So, I focused my final project on manufactured housing productions. To preface, manufactured homes are often known by a variety of names. Mobile homes, trailer parks, trailers, but I use the terminology manufactured home because it's most accurate. This is because manufactured homes do come to properties on wheels, but when they're put into manufactured home communities, these wheels are often removed and the homes become immobile. On top of that, because these homes are immobile, to actually relocate the home, it costs thousands upon thousands of dollars. Additionally, there are very few parks that will accept used homes, and often communities, other manufactured home communities, also don't have any space to take any other homes. So mobile home is a little bit inaccurate. So we say manufactured home community. Typically, manufactured home residents buy their homes, but not the land that their home sits on. That is rented to them by the community owner. The community owner often provides utilities. However, every community differs. Manufactured homes are a critical source of affordable housing. Yet with growing demands for developable land, the residents of these communities are being forced out of their homes. I want to give a little context and understanding to this issue with a story. Before Bethlehem Township became some of the most developable land in the Lehigh Valley, it was home to many manufactured home communities, one of which was Peaceful Meadows. This community was home to over 40 families, nearly every one of which was elderly, taking care of a disabled family member, and or low income. Many in this manufactured home community lived there for decades, but as the price of land rose, the community owner decided to capitalize and sold it to a local developer who proposed essentially leveling out the manufactured home community and putting a home development on top of it. These houses in that home development would have had sale prices several times higher than the manufactured home residents' homes, leaving them no choice but to have to leave and abandon their homes. Fortunately, in this situation, advocates stepped in and tried to help the residents relocate. However, this isn't always the case. In this situation, advocates were able to raise money to pay for relocation costs, which, as I said before, are typically thousands of dollars that residents can't afford. However, even in this case, they couldn't find any other manufactured home within at least 30 miles that would accept a used home, whether it was 2 months old or 10 years old and in perfect condition. And this is all too common. Residents are often forced to abandon their homes and all they invested into it when their community is sold. Even in cases where the community is not sold to be redeveloped and it's sold to still stay a manufactured home community, rent is often increased severely as soon as a new owner comes in, to the point where many residents are again forced to leave. Right now, the Manufactured Housing and Community Rights Act only requires owners to pay a minimum of $2,500 or the appraised value of a home, whichever is greater, if a resident is unable to find a replacement site, which of course is quite common. It is important to note, though, that manufactured homes are titled, not deeded, so they depreciate in the same way that a car does. This means residents like those in Peaceful Meadows had outstanding loans for their homes, lost their homes, but still owed costly payments on their homes that they no longer had. The residents in Peaceful Meadows didn't just have their lives disrupted. The sale was a huge financial loss for most. Kids were uprooted and forced to change schools, and the residents' homes that they worked so hard to own and where they could find comfort and rest were taken away from them. Far too often, in situations like this, manufactured homeowners end up in severe debt or homeless. As more and more of Pennsylvania sprawls, the story of Peaceful Meadows has become a common reality. The story demonstrates that we must protect manufactured home residents from park sales. And to do this, we must encourage resident-owned communities. I've created a package of bills that would amend two sections of the Manufactured Home Community Rights Act that would work to do just this. In the event that a manufactured home community owner decides to sell their community, the first piece of my legislation would exempt them from the Pennsylvania Realty Transfer Tax upon the condition that they sell their community to its residents or a nonprofit representing the community residents. This aim is to help ensure that community owners sell their communities to its residents. This loss in tax revenue would be minimal compared to what the Commonwealth could stand to gain. When a manufactured community becomes a self-governing cooperative, it typically produces greater civic engagement, reduces police phone calls, and lessens the burden on social services. Moreover, there are often greater investments in infrastructure improvements that benefit the environment and community. This greater stability will likely even increase the community's tax base. Although this might seem like an impossible feat for residents to band together and put down quite a bit of money to buy their community, we've seen it happen throughout the country. ROC USA, or Resident Owned Communities USA, is a nationwide program that aids communities in acquiring loans and buying out their communities. Loan programs like this also exist in many other states on the state level, for example, in New Hampshire. These measures, coupled with other protective measures, can make resident-owned communities a reality. The second piece of my bill package would help create some of these protections that I referenced. It extends the number of days in which residents must be notified of the community's sale from 30 days to 60. This will give residents an opportunity to come together and obtain a loan if they decide to buy their community. And if not, it gives them more time to figure out where they're going to go. This legislation will also provide residents with a right of first refusal, which grants residents a competitive advantage in acquiring their community. The right of first refusal would ensure that if the residents are able to meet and match or exceed the offer provided by a potential buyer, that the community owner sells to them rather than someone from the outside. These measures will encourage resident community ownership and allow residents to live without fear of being displaced. No matter what side of the aisle you are on, we can get behind more safe and affordable housing. And this issue does have bipartisan support. Previously, Representative Freeman introduced legislation that provided some of these relocation measures that I have referenced in my speech. Similarly, last session, Representative Mao introduced legislation that prevents residents from having to pay taxes higher than their manufactured home values. We are all recognizing that this is a problem. Various other states have already offered measures to encourage resident community ownership. For example, in both Republican and Democratic controlled states like Massachusetts, Minnesota, New Jersey, Connecticut, and Florida, residents are offered the right of first refusal and longer periods of notice. Pennsylvania must catch up and pass these critical provisions. We cannot continue to let our elderly, disabled, and low-income families continue to be taken advantage of. We must protect affordable housing. I'm open to any questions.
Your legislation looks great.
Thank you.
I did have one question. So in your speech, you mentioned that most communities won't allow used manufactured homes to be placed within the community. Why?
There's a variety of reasons. Number one, it's sales for their own community, right? They don't want someone else to bring in a new home when they can sell one of their own. Also, on top of that, it often varies community to community, but if there is a community with, like, for example, a bunch of double-wide mobile homes, they don't want someone coming in with a single, or they don't want someone coming in with a more dated home that might look different because they're afraid of how it'll affect property values. Regardless, it's still incredibly hard to find, even find communities that have space, let alone that will accept a used home. So that's kind of why, but you'd even struggle just finding somewhere with an open space, to be honest.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, go for it.
So congratulations on your legislation.
Thank you.
And you're the expert in the field on this because I only have limited information. So I understand some mobile parks, manufactured home communities, have at times shared septic systems, not expansive or anything, but maybe one or two homes sharing a system. In the event of, you know, an individual family having to purchase their own home, it's compared to like a developer buying out the entire property, how would you go about ensuring that each family then has to go through getting their own septic system put into it? Is there any consideration for the legislation to include that those kind of provisions for it?
Actually, the way that my legislation is set up, one resident can't just say, I'm going to buy the entire community. That doesn't work, right? So right now, the way it's set up is to receive that property tax exemption and to actually buy the community, you would need 50% of the community, you know, in some sort of resident association, tenant association, coming together plus one, so majority plus one, you know, to do that. So at that point, the community is within the community's reach, and they can kind of deem how they want to divide up. You know, I'm assuming each lot would have their own land that they would then, you know, buy the land to hopefully deed it. To my knowledge, I don't think that would cut off anybody's access to septic if the entire community has it. But I think at that point, the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Alliance would probably have to step in on a case-by-case basis.
Understood, then. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. Anything else? Cool. Thank you.
Next, we have Nathaniel McLeod. His legislation is amending Title 25, the Elections Code of the Pennsylvania Consolidated Statutes, and voter registration, providing for voter registration application receipts and penalties, further providing for registration and imposing penalties.
Thank you, Nicole. Hello, I'm Nathaniel McLeod. I'm a senior at Dickinson College. I'd like to say thank you to Keisha and Nicole for putting this event together and organizing the entire fellowship. I'd also like to thank the members of the Legislative Policy and Research Office for their support throughout this entire semester, and especially the Human Services Unit, which just showed me an incredible amount of kindness and made sure that I could learn as much as possible in these last 3 months. In the fall of 2022, an organization conducted a voter registration drive at Dickinson College, and some number of students participated that, when they went to the polls on election day, were unable to vote. They were told that they had not actually been registered to vote. The organization responsible for the registration drive couldn't be identified after the fact, and these people that had turned in their voter registration forms had no recourse against the organization, had no voice in an election, even though they had done all the right things and showed up on election day to make their attempt to cast a ballot. They had done everything that we expect from a person, but still were disenfranchised despite that. Worse, it's unclear whether there would be a way to hold the culprit accountable even if the organization could have been identified. Currently, the penalties within Pennsylvania election law apply to elections officials in penalizing interference with registration. While there is one paragraph that may seem to prohibit any person from interfering with registration, it seems to apply after applications are filed and not before. My legislation seeks to fill the gap in our current election law. If passed, people who collect voter registration forms would be required to submit them to the appropriate county office and would face a penalty for failing to do so. To make this requirement enforceable, any person soliciting completion of registration forms or providing them and offering to return them to the county office would be required to provide a receipt to each applicant which provided information about the organization and information about when to expect a voter registration card. If an organization failed to provide this receipt, they would also face a penalty. To accomplish both these goals, the bill would amend Title 25 to require that any person who receives a voter registration application submit it to the county office. The penalties for violating this law would be graded based on the type of culpability and the number of offenses. For all intentional or knowing offenses of the law, where a person knew that they were disenfranchising someone. The failure to file the form would be a summary offense with a penalty of $300 or 90 days imprisonment or both. However, in cases of negligence, the penalties are tiered to avoid penalizing people who had an accident with a single form of a friend or family that they just happened to lose with no malintention. If someone would fail to file a form due to negligence and it was their first offense, then the fine would be only $25. However, for a second offense or greater, or a first offense involving 10 or more ballots, then the penalties would be the same as intentional or knowing offenses, with the $300 fine or 90 days imprisonment or both. The thought behind this structure is that with a goal of deterrence, there is no benefit to penalizing the minor failure of losing a single ballot for, or a single registration form of a friend or family member. A summary offense would be too harsh in this situation, and someone in these circumstances should not end up with a criminal record, and it would not support registration security or election access. However, negligent loss of ballots is a serious problem and needs to be addressed. Voters' registration efforts need to take responsibility for the applicants and applications that they receive, because access is key to the right to vote. This proposal would make sure that voter registration organizations are engaging in proper practices to ensure that voter registration forms are returned to the county office. People have the chance to make one mistake, but then they know the law, and repeated mistakes with registration forms or mishandling of large groups of registration forms would be penalized. At the same time, these penalties are not so severe that legitimate voter registration efforts would be put off from conducting voter registration drives. To make this rule enforceable, this bill would also require that people soliciting receipt of applications, would provide a receipt for to each applicant. The receipt would be required to include the contact information of the voter registration organization, for instance, the phone number or an email address, and would also inform the applicant about the timeline for expecting a voter registration card, as well as inform the applicant about how to contact the Department of State about their application to vote. The requirement that registration drives provide a receipt would help to protect voter registration organizations from these issues by creating a record of the organization responsible and providing applicants with information about how to keep up to date on their application. The receipt requirements protect organizations from applicants who believe them their forms were lost. It also gives applicants resources to identify problems and resolve them on their own, and more informed applicants are less likely to have issues. Ensuring widespread participation in elections within our Commonwealth is so important. This bill will promote both election access and election security in one swoop. It will support applicants in the registration process and protect voter registration organizations. This bill will be a step forward for elections in Pennsylvania. Thank you for your time.
Nick.
Hey, Nat. I think it's crazy that your legislation isn't already part of statute. So yeah, I'd love to see this implemented. So I had two questions. The first one being, your inspiration for this was an event that took place at Dickinson. Were you directly involved with this, or is this just something you had seen happen?
No, I was not. I never switched my registration at college. I wanted to vote at home. So I didn't personally see the person who was taking registration forms, nor did I show up to the polls in Carlisle to talk to people. But there were enough people that had this issue that when we were reporting on it for the student newspaper, which I'm involved in, that we could talk to multiple different people, and it was a campus discussion, like multiple people had heard about it. I'd also say, like, it's though it's not like widely talked about, when I've talked about this idea to people, they've mentioned like, oh yeah, that happened at my college, or you know, I've heard of incidents like that. So this is an ongoing problem, even though it's not super well publicized.
Okay. And then my second question, I was curious what the inspiration was for the creation of your penalties, of the first one being $20 for a negligent or just $300 outright. Like, did you take this from another piece of statute, or did you just come up with this?
So I took the summary offense on the advice of some of the people I sought feedback from, because we wanted to try and find a penalty that wasn't too severe, that it would end up deterring legitimate voter registration efforts from trying to sign people up to vote. And as part of that, you know, there was this constant balance about trying to make sure that somebody who had accidentally failed to file a single ballot wasn't penalized too severely either. So I hadn't seen anything like that in law in other places, and had come up with this structure with some advice and feedback from different people. It's not modeled on anything in particular.
Now, if they accidentally failed to do, say, five ballots, is it still just $20 for the first offense?
Yeah, it would be a single offense in that case. Yeah.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Hello, Nat. So I want to talk a bit more about the penalties involved with the legislation, and kind of get a better understanding your reasons for why you chose the amounts that you did. Specifically, you know, there is a lot of data to suggest that fines have historically impacted more severely people who are of low income, as well as people of color, especially with monetary fines. And I just wanted to understand your reasoning for putting this as a criminal offense rather than giving a student or a person civil standing to go seek monetary damages, or instead of a prison time, requiring like community service instead to give back to the community that they've impacted.
Sure, I appreciate that concern. I had initially pursued it as a criminal penalty because I wanted to match the other requirements in Title 25 within the registration section. And I think that's appropriate because, as was the case at Dickinson, people who are using a voter registration drive to apply to register to vote probably don't have the resources or knowledge to know that there would be the opportunity to pursue civil penalties against somebody who had mishandled their ballot, and it might be more difficult for them to establish a case. So by making a criminal penalty instead, the resources are there for the Attorney General, which Title 25 gives the power to prosecute the crimes under it, the go-ahead to pursue these penalties. As to why I pursued a summary offense as the penalty, I was trying to match the penalties contained within Title 25, as I said before. But as the goal is, you know, a deterrent effect in most cases, if community service or similar penalties would have the appropriate deterrent effect, then those could be appropriate penalties as well.
Understood. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Stephen. Great. Thank you.
Our final presenter is Alex Simmons, and Alex's legislation is providing for personal financial literacy graduation course requirement and further providing for economic education and personal financial literary programs. He also establishes the Personal Financial Literacy Tax Credit Program within the Department of Community and Economic Development.
Well, hi, my name is Alex Simmons. I'm a student at Penn State Harrisburg. I'm currently majoring in political science while also minoring in economics. And for the past 13 weeks, I've had the great pleasure of being able to work alongside the House Transportation Committee. First, I'd like to give a great thanks to Josiah, my supervisor and executive director, as well as James and Larissa, the transportation staff. Y'all have been fantastic in guiding me and assisting me the last 13 weeks and really making sure I got the most out of this experience in learning about state government. With that, today I am here to discuss with you the quality of our students' education, specifically within the realm of finance. Now, I can stand here and I can make an argument that there is no greater subject of importance in finance. After all, money really controls just about everything around us. It controls our decision-making, what we spend our time on, our career path, and really overall our future. Something so pivotal to our lives and in ways controlling of our lives simply cannot be undertaught in our schools. But unfortunately, however, this is the reality our education system faces. Currently, there is no statewide high school graduation course requirement for financial literacy in Pennsylvania. With this, we leave future generations clueless on finance in a country where 62% of Americans live paycheck to paycheck. The average American household is $155,000 in debt, and the total student loan debt in the United States just reached a record high of $1.75 trillion. We simply cannot be leaving young people oblivious to a subject as crucial as financial literacy, especially when an estimated 60% of high school students go directly into the workforce and make, on average, $20,000 less than someone with a college degree. This is exactly why my legislation mandates that every high school student across Pennsylvania shall fulfill a 1/2 credit requirement for financial literacy in order to graduate. If this mandate were to happen, Pennsylvania would become the 22nd state to do so. And while it would have been great to have been first on this list, I guess you can say it's better to be late than never. On top of this mandate, the bill will also create a statewide curriculum in which each school must follow. Now, while some schools have taken the initiatives themselves in already requiring financial literacy for their students, the curriculum across these schools vary, and sometimes they can vary greatly. Some students, while being required to take financial literacy, are missing out on key information and principles that are vital to a sound education because of this variation. So my legislation works to create a universal curriculum across the state so that no child is missing the key principles to a successful financial education. This curriculum includes topics such as credit and debit, mortgages and loans, preparing and filing your taxes, your checking and savings accounts, investing and managing your debt. With this curriculum, we make sure that no student is missing any of the important principles related to financial literacy. Now, I do know what some of you may be wondering. With this new mandate, how will schools get the funding in order to make this happen? Well, with the current state of education funding in Pennsylvania, this is a fantastic and important question to ask. That's why my bill also creates the Financial Literacy Tax Credit Program. This program would give businesses and individuals a tax credit if they donate money towards an educational improvement organization. These organizations will then be responsible for allocating these funds to school districts and charter schools for the purpose of funding the school's financial literacy program or any other courses related to finance or economics. The total aggregate amount of this tax credit accumulates to around $100 million, with $70 million set aside for businesses and $30 million set aside for individuals. Now, $100 million may seem like a large number, but it is only the total estimated cost for all Pennsylvania schools to require a new graduation course requirement. And while this may not solve the underfunding of Pennsylvania education, well, it's a solution to assisting schools with the extra burdens that come along with mandating a new class. Another common concern when it comes to new graduation requirements is, well, graduation requirements make it harder to graduate. However, with my bill, schools have an option to incorporate this 1/2 credit requirement within the already existing credit requirements. My bill allows for school districts and charter schools to choose whether the financial literacy graduation requirement shall fulfill a social studies credit, a family consumer science credit, or a business education credit. With every school already requiring social studies credits to graduate, as well as some schools already requiring family consumer science and business education credits to graduate already, there are options for these schools to include financial literacy within the credit requirements that are already in place. On top of this, 12% of school districts in the Commonwealth already have a financial literacy graduation requirement in place. This leaves the number of students who will be negatively affected by this to a minute level. However, for those students who are affected, I ask you what is more important. I ask you what is more devastating. Struggling in financial literacy, but in the process learning important financial principles, or never learning these financial principles and making such costly financial mistakes at such a young age? To me, I choose the latter. According to the American Public Education Foundation, Financial stress is the second most common cause of suicide. Domestic violence occurs more often when a couple is experiencing financial distress. And those with high financial distress are twice as likely to report poor overall health. To me, a short-term struggle helps bear the burdens of greater struggles in the future. And with these scary but reality-painting statistics, should we still be allowing future generations of this Commonwealth to graduate with zero personal financial knowledge? To me, that answer is an easy and absolute no. And I hope that is the same for you. Thank you very much, and I am now open to any questions you may have. Yes.
I have a couple of questions for you. I think this is a great program. I am glad to say that my high school touched on this a little bit, not to the level that your bill would establish, but we did learn some things. So first off, the previous presentation touched on the shortage of teachers. So I was curious, if a school doesn't already have a teacher that is preparing a course on financial literacy, would they then have to just give this to another teacher, say a gym teacher or a business teacher or a social studies teacher? Or would this be them hiring a teacher to specifically teach this subject?
That's a fantastic question, and I hope some of that problem is fixed with something like Dalton's bill. However, there's most schools already have like an elective option for financial literacy. So most schools around the Commonwealth already have a personal like financial literacy teacher in place. For the schools who don't, there's a lot of options for teachers such as teachers who are already in economics, teachers who are in social studies. Social studies teachers are able to really teach a wide range of content, and I think financial literacy would be one of those. So I think there's a lot of options to be able to make sure that schools are not struggling with the supply of teachers in this mandate.
And then my second question touches on your credit program for like school credits for graduation. Mm-hmm. Is that required, or would that just be an option for schools moving forward? Because I was curious if, because some might feel that it's taking away from the consumer science or the social studies or the business programs.
The financial literacy tax credit itself is an option for schools. They don't have to accept these credits. Educational improvement organizations don't have to opt in. Businesses don't have to apply they do have to apply, but they have the option to not apply. So everybody has an option, especially public schools and charter schools, to be able to not accept this money if they don't need to.
Well, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Yes.
First and foremost, I think it's a fantastic bill. And so the question I have isn't so much, it's more so to get your thought process on including a certain provision. So in your presentation, you mentioned the impact of student loans that is currently in what I think you mentioned a trillion some dollars of debt currently with the student loans. And looking at the outline of your financial literacy course, the only section relating to loans in general is like subsection 3, the basic principles of mortgages and loans. So I wondered if you could give a pros and cons for why or why not to include a quick section saying like the basic principles of like filing for FAFSA, student loans in general, and like the ethical decisions of like whether or not you should take out a loan in that kind of capacity.
That's a really good question. I believed when I wrote down the curriculum, and there's been passed legislation as well that has touched on this topic. They leave it to just managing loans and really give it a more broad range in order for schools to really choose how they would like to. I see kind of how that can be an issue. If this were to go through an actual mandatory process, I'd be happy to kind of strict up that curriculum a little bit to make sure everything like you just included is included, and make sure that students are, in fact, learning all of that.
Understood. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
A little bit about charter schools versus just public schools. and the tax credit that would hopefully get them to be involved in that. I went to an incredibly small private school in Philadelphia where we had like very little teachers. My school probably wouldn't have been able to handle adding another class like that. And because of that, a lot of students like myself really struggled with doing FAFSA and loans. Could you talk a little bit about how you would try to encourage a lot of, because there are a lot of private schools in our Commonwealth, especially in the Philadelphia area, that usually cater to either lower income students or students who are already on scholarships there. So can you talk a little bit about how you would put that financial literacy class into more charter and private schools versus just the public schools that are catering to the majority of our students?
Mm-hmm. Well, with my financial literacy tax credit, charter schools are implemented within that. I chose not to add in private schools because while there are some lower income private schools, most private schools is usually higher income families that are sending their children to those areas, and I did not want to assist some of those schools while in the process may not helping some lower income schools, private schools, just mainly because private school is kind of like a secondary option outside of public school, and you really do not have to go to a private school. What this mostly is about is assisting public schools and charter schools who really, they don't have an option to go to a private schools, and private schools are able to just also raise their tuition to help with some of these costs. So I was mainly most focused on making sure that charter schools and public schools were able to get the funding they need because they have no option to raise tuition. And if they don't have that option, then they would have to do something like raise property taxes, which can affect all of you here. So that was really my thinking. I see how that can be an issue, and if this were to actually go through a process, I absolutely hope the General Assembly would take that into account.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Anyone else? Thank you very much.
So, great job, everyone. I wanted to just congratulate you all in completing the fellowship program, and if we could give them all just one more round of applause. This class of fellows has had a unique start, an historic start to their semester here, from waiting to see which members would chair committees to witnessing two speakers of the House, one of which is the first woman speaker of the House. They adjusted wonderfully, and we are certainly proud of you and the work that you completed during your time here. We've really enjoyed getting to know you guys and spending time with you this semester. You will take this experience with you, and I'm sure it will help you as you grow and you've had the opportunity to make lifelong friends, great colleagues, and connections within your experience here. We'll be keeping up with you, and we hope to hear good things from you guys in the future and look forward to learning about where you end up after here. So congratulations again, and Keisha and I will be presenting you guys with the certificate of your accomplishment, and I will read the certificate. It does say a certificate of recognition presented to Katarina, Dalton, Ariana, Nathaniel, and Alex in recognition of outstanding accomplishments and contributions in the Pennsylvania House of Representatives Legislative Fellowship Program, January 18th through April 13th, 2023. And it was signed by the Chief Clerk, the Majority Leader and Majority Whip, the Speaker, Minority Leader, and Minority Whip. Lunch will be served soon. We do have our photographer here, so if you guys would like to get some photos with the fellows, please do. And we encourage you to walk around the Capitol and to check out the House archives over in the Irvis Office Building. It's truly a magnificent building to work in. We're very fortunate, and we thank you all for coming and hope you all have a great day.